Okay, so glad you all made it. I have to say, I've had to make an extra cup of coffee this morning in preparation for this workshop. If you looked at the syllabus I sent out, it's kind of confusing even to me, and I'll do my best to unpack this for you. But as I was thinking about it yesterday, I actually had a mild bit of anxiety because I'm thinking, I may not even know how to teach this. I'll do my best, but I honestly am not sure I know what makes a musician expressive, other than the fact that when you hear them play, it sounds amazing and you feel like you have been emotionally touched by the music. It wasn't just like a dry experience. So that's the kernel of today's talk, if you will. And we'll go through a bunch of different things that surround expression. It's almost like musical expression is this sort of mysterious orb, some quantum substance that we can't really get to, but I can point at it from a number of different directions, and that's what I will attempt to do today. I think you could probably put it in a nutshell. Here is it in a nutshell. It's dark in here and kind of brown and smells like nuts. Why am I in a nutshell? No. So basically, what we want to do is look at the difference between this something that's fancy and this. So to me, that second lick said more. It had more expression, even though the first lick had a lot more notes, technique, and virtuosity. So right there, you can see the good news is you don't have to be exceptionally good on your instrument to be able to express yourself. Some of the most expressive players, Mississippi John Hurt, Big Bill Brunzi, blues players, were not technicians. Their guitars were often, you know, slightly out of tune and had pieces missing, and their solos were very simple, but they said so much with few notes. So I guess I'd like to start today's class by saying, don't think this is one of those workshops where you have to study a whole bunch of techniques to be able to play expressively. However, you do need one thing, and that's notes. You need to be able to make notes. I think that we can all agree on that. So we have to have sources of notes. And I like to think of it this way. Where do notes live? Well, notes generally live, if you look at the essential tools under item one, in three areas. Arpeggios, scales, and intervals. The first couple items on this list are sort of kind of going over basics, and we've covered them in other classes, but I thought we'd be safe by covering them. So y'all know what scales are. And arpeggios are taking a chord, like say a G chord, and playing the notes separately. So we have the notes of that chord played separately, not together. That's an arpeggio. Intervals are you take two notes and you mix them. So pretty much everything we're going to discuss today comes from those three areas where we gather our notes, chords, scales, and arpeggios. So that's up to each of us on our own time to make sure we have our proper studies and we're learning our scales, arpeggios, and our intervals. And then we have the tools to express ourselves, okay? So under item 1B, we talk about basic improvisation skills. I'm gonna refer that to another workshop I did. Let it be known, however, to utilize any of the concepts I'm gonna teach you today, you do have to have some basic abilities to improvise. In other words, to play your notes in a random order, not reading off a page, and create notes out of thin air. That's kind of the prerequisite. If you haven't done this, and most of my folks here have, then I will refer you to my JamAlong workshop on improvisation. So, item two, let's look at the opposite of expression. Sometimes it's good to look at what we don't want to do, okay? I say that a lot to my banjo students. We don't want to sound like a chicken stuck in a vacuum cleaner. That's the opposite of what we want to sound like. We want to be a free-range chicken making lots of happy clucking noises. So playing stuff literally is the opposite of expression. Like playing everything as if it is a exercise. So this is not expressive at all. It's a structure. Okay? Now, this, same notes, same scale, but I mixed it up, I made it into music. So the first thing we want to understand is, after we learn our tools, the scales, the arpeggios, and the intervals, we want to do everything we can to take a hammer and smash them up and make them a random pile of notes so we can reassemble them with emotion added, okay? That's where the magic happens. Now, looking at item 2B, we talk about exercises. I teach a lot of exercises, not as much as some teachers, but I like scale patterns, for example. Or a scale pattern going down. Once again, kind of fancy, kind of neat, but not very expressive. You can use it in a solo. If I do this, I used a bit of it to get somewhere, but my playing was primarily free. Now, item C under two, and this is an emotional quotient here, the anxiety factor and the underconfidence factor. Those of you who haven't played a lot in public know very well that when we show up to our Zoom lessons and I'm sitting here staring at you, and even though I'm a nice fellow, and I say, hey, can I hear you play that thing we learned? All of a sudden, you've got a little bit of anxiety and you feel slightly less confident than you did before I showed up. This is one of the killers of expression, and that's why the more we play in front of people, the more we're able to express ourselves. So there is the factor where if I'm playing a show, and I've had many, where I'm just not comfortable, I'm gonna stick to my basic stuff I know. I'm not gonna go out on a limb. I'm gonna make sure that I'm playing everything safe because I wanna get through the evening. I don't really wanna take any chances. If I'm having a great time around the campfire with good friends, I'm probably gonna play more expressively. So the answer to C under two, anxiety and underconfidence, is very simple. Repeat, 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 repeat. Play in front of as many humans as you can. I have some beginners where I have them do what I call the park bench drill. Go to a park, sit on the bench, hopefully by a jogging path, play your instrument. Someone strolls by, maybe even stops to listen. Don't drop your instrument and go fetal and rock back and forth. Keep playing, whatever happens. You might be nervous, you might be terrified, but we keep playing. And that'll give us the confidence to start to take risks to express ourselves on our instrument. This takes time. I'm gonna say right now, I'm a bit nervous right now. I'm just hiding it really well because I'm not sure this subject is not gonna crash entirely. I think I'm gonna pull it off, but it's a wild subject. We're not talking about music. We're talking about the energy that comes through music, out of our emotions. And there's really no textbook on this. I haven't found one, and I looked. Now, let's go on to item three. This is sort of a review of material we covered in the improvisation workshop, but it's so important that I think it behooves going over again. I call it the three R's, and most of y'all know what this is. This is making sure we use these tools to break up our scales, arpeggios, and intervals so they don't become exercises. So the first R is rest. I'm gonna demonstrate this really quick because we've all been through this. Here's my G scale. I got a beat, right? Rest, rest, rest. I'm letting time go by. Now repeats. Rest again. Now, here's another opposite of expression. If I'm playing everything the same time, even if I'm creative, it sounds like a computer. I have to have different densities of rhythms. That's the third R. So it's easy to think of it as slow, medium, and fast. Here's medium. Slow. Medium. Fast. Slow again. Generally, there's a lot more tempos than those three, but as you're getting started, if you have the third R grouped in the slow, medium, and fast, it's very helpful to break up that typing sound, okay? So that was kind of a review. That's sort of the things you have to have. Now, this is a technique I've talked with some of you about. Let's look at item four. I call this the canvas of silence. It sounds spooky and kind of Yoda, but it's really just a matter of turning upside down your model of playing. And this is really good for banjo players who tend to be fond of lots of notes, because we can make lots of notes. But sometimes that's not the most expressive thing to do. So for example, if I'm playing, and I'm going to take, this is going to be a challenge. Once again, I'm challenging myself in this class. I'm going to take 9-pound hammer, a bluegrass song, on a banjo. Not commonly thought of as an emotionally expressive experience. And let's see if we can apply the concept of the canvas of silence. Here's the standard banjo approach. 1, 2, 3. Now, what if I start my solo with not playing anything? 1, 2, 3, 4. Thinking of playing notes, I'm thinking of not playing notes, and every now and then adding something. As you can see, it sounds a little odd in bluegrass, although you can get away with it. It's more common in jazz and more common in blues. So let me take an instrument not always associated with the blues, but as my ukulele students know, we can get very bluesy on this little guitar here. Let's say you're playing a blues solo. To noodle around on my scale, okay? As opposed to starting right in, I'm gonna let silence start, put a couple notes in, go back to the canvas of silence. 1, 2, 3, 4. Was 50% silence and 50% notes. And all of a sudden you start to see we turned the paradigm on its head. We're starting with silence and adding a few notes. I'm telling you, this has changed the way I think. This is some of this stuff's new for me. I discovered it while I was writing the syllabus. And I'm like, holy cow, I should try this. And it's changed the way I play. So that's what I call the starting and ending with silence. And then item B under fours rests as commas. It's helpful to think of our playing, especially when we're improvising, as talking, because essentially that's what we're doing, using notes. So if we're playing with, let's say, a G scale on the mandolin, okay, let's say a bluegrass pentatonic scale, and I want to say a sentence. I'm going to go, whatever that said, if it had words, I'm a-goin', walkin' to the store, I'm saying something, okay? You can fill in the meaning there. I'm gonna make sure I put a comma. Big comma, then I do it again. Put a big comma. Comma. I'm making sure that I stop on purpose every 10, 15 notes. Now, wind players have to do that, because guess what? They have to breathe in. Imagine that. You run out of notes because you run out of air, so you have no choice but to put a rest in there. It's helpful for us string players to think that way. I even had a really esoteric jazz teacher make me do that. It was kind of weird looking, but I would take a breath. I would play as I slowly breathed out. When I ran out of breath, I would stop and breathe in and then get to play again. It looks really weird. It's like some crazy yoga thing, and I got too dizzy to keep doing it eventually. But it did help me understand the importance of commas as rests. Now, moving on to item 5, we're going to continue on that idea with phrasing, okay? A lot of you work with me what I call three-phrase soloing, which is a blues technique. And it works for all instruments once again. And I'm going to demonstrate on the mandolin. And once again, this was reviewed. Some of this stuff is rehashed from other workshops because it's all the same tools. But three-phrase soloing, as those of you who know are working with me on this, is extremely powerful because it changes the way we build our phrases. And it comes from the blues. And let me demonstrate. When you're singing a blues song, when you hear blues lyrics, here's what happens. They say something. They say the same thing again. And the third time, they repeat it and rhyme it. So it's almost like a funny little lyric of a limerick of some sort. I'm going to do my favorite demonstration blues song here. Watch how I phrase the three lines. Well, I got me a good gal. She's sure nice to me. It goes to the next chord. I say the same thing. I got me a good gal. She's sure nice to me. Now I got a rhyme. She comes home every night drunk and beats the crap out of me. Okay, I know, same old story, but hey, it happened a lot. So now we take that and we turn it into an instrumental line. Guess what happens, ladies and germs? We get a whole new style of playing. And some of you have already learned the three-phrase blues solo. Some of you have been assigned to compose them, but you know they're really easy in essence because all you're really writing is two lines. And the second, third one has to be different. So I'm gonna go like this. Here's my first line. I let a whole bunch of time go by. And then the C chord comes around, the four chord, I do the same thing again. Now I've got a rhyme. The five chord is my rhyme. And then I've got a blues lyric on my instrument. Now, that doesn't apply to every kind of music, but it does show us that repetition of phrases and silence are two very important elements to this whole process of how do we play and sound like we're saying something, not just regurgitating a ton of notes, all right? So now we're gonna look at, we talked about B under five, the breath, okay, like a wind instrument. Let's talk about call and response. This is something that's more challenging, but I want you to try this when you're sitting around noodling on your instrument. You play any little phrase, and if you see if you can do that same phrase higher up in register. It doesn't have to be an octave. It could be just so many intervals above or below. So let's say I have this phrase. And I'm going to go. Now I'm going to directly talk to myself. So you see there's a distinct conversation happening now. That's call and response. And you'll hear a lot of older style jazz, like Dixieland jazz, gypsy jazz. They will do that in their playing. They'll have a conversation with their own instrument. You can do that on any instrument. Just remember to stop, move somewhere else, try to create a similar shape of sound, and we'll touch on that in a minute, sound shapes, and then go back and forth from the two. Now, item six. Now we start getting into the esoteric stuff. Stuff that we haven't talked about a lot in our lessons. Dynamics. This is the stuff other than the actual pitch. So far, everything we've been doing has been concerned with the pitch of a note. What notes are we playing? Well, generally what distinguishes a note from another note is higher or lower, right? Well, there's other qualities of sound that can distinguish a note. One is volume, okay? If I have two phrases, if I'm doing a call and response, I can call and respond using dynamics. I can go like this. I'm going high and low and high and low. Dynamics. It's not just important to play quiet on your backup and loud on your lead, because I'm always preaching to you guys about that. It's also important to use dynamics in your playing during your soloing to make it more expressive. So under dynamics six, item A is volume. Let me demonstrate on the banjo. Banjos generally aren't known for being quiet and subtle. So when we become quiet and subtle, it shocks the hell out of people. They're like, wow, what is that over there? I thought it was a banjo. It can also be a musical instrument. Surprise, surprise. So let's demonstrate that. I'm gonna play a little bluegrass banjo. So let's say I do this. Soft to help flavor my phrasing. If I had played that all at the same volume, it wouldn't have had the same drama to it. It would be less expressive, okay? Now we'll talk about B under six, tone as expression. Once again, picking on my banjo people, we always want to be aware of our hand being down by the bridge or our hand being up by the fingerboard in what we call the Y position, X position, Y position. Why? Because this is crispy. Ralph Stanley all day long. This is soft. By the way, that works with any instrument, not just the banjo. You have an X and Y position on each instrument. X is closer to the bridge. Y is closer to the fingerboard. Watch how different that is. Here's my phrase in the X position. Now here's the Y position. It's almost like a different instrument. It really is. And on mandolin, for example, a lot of people forget that. And on ukulele, people hardly ever think of that. Is the fact that if you move your hand as far as you can up towards your fingerboard and keep playing, you get this really dulcet, soft, beautiful sound. And if you are right by the bridge, you get a really crispy, snappy, almost kind of brittle sound. Bill Monroe loved to do this lick right here, right by the bridge. It was one of his blues maneuvers, right? David Grisman loves to move over here and go, because he's a jazz cat for a large part. But you can have both. So now I'm going to demonstrate. I'm soloing, and I'm going to use the X and Y position to change the emotion of my solo. Check it out. To me, that was more expressive because I had a wider range of tone. So we've talked about volume as expression, tone as expression, sharp or soft, and now item C under six is legato versus staccato. This is where you can let a note ring out or you can chop it off. And it can be the same notes but have different emotional content. So let's take a very easy scale phrase. Let's say pentatonic scale, y'all know I love that scale. Okay, here's legato. Here's staccato. Same phrase, totally different emotion. Literally the same lick played with cut off notes or letting them ring out. A lot of times banjo people, for example, play staccato only. Everything they do is like a machine gun rattle of notes because that's kind of the style in a lot of bluegrass. What if we played a legato, meaning longer notes? Granted, we're playing a bongo on a stick, so there's not a lot of sustain to begin with, but you can coax some sustain out of the instrument with a little bit of thought. So for example, here's a phrase, played staccato. Same thing legato. Same exact lick, two entirely different emotions. That's why dynamics is something we often don't think about. When you're soloing, I challenge you to think about being loud and then soft, being sharp and then mellow, and then being long notes, legato, versus choppy notes, staccato. That's quite fascinating. And you can put that all together, and now we have... Now we have like a lot more colors to play with when we're playing. Okay, now we're moving on to page two. I want to make sure I cover all the material here because I have a whole lot to regurgitate. Let's look at seven, playing with time. First of all, we have the divisions of notes. This relates to the third R in my 3R theory, different rhythms. So basically, when you're soloing and improvising, you want to try to be thinking of how many different ways you can play over a beat. Hey, here's a great game you can play with your metronome. Set it to something mellow, like 90 beats a minute or something, 80 beats a minute. Then what we're gonna do is see how many ways we can match that tone. Here's literally. Here's double. quadruple. That's a literal. There's every other. Now we're talking, that's all square divisions. What about triplets? What about threes and sixes? We haven't even touched on that. Here's triplets. Slow triplets. Very fast triplets. So, there's at least a half a dozen different densities you can use between slow and fast when you're improvising, and that's not quite so expressive, but it gives you variety, and variety is a big key here, okay? Now let's talk about B under 7, rubato, kind of an interesting Italian word in classical music, meaning essentially not bound to the beat, kind of a floating time. And this is, once again, a concept that people often do, even though they don't know they're doing it. Some people do it by mistake. We're talking about doing it on purpose, meaning we're playing slightly out of the meter on purpose. So let's say we had, something slow like Wayfaring Stranger. Now, if I was going to improvise over that and use sort of a floating time feel, I would do something like this. Kind of go a little faster than the beat, a little slower than the beat, on purpose though, okay? This is something you have to do after many years of playing in time before you drift from the beat on purpose. But that is a thing. In fact, in classical music, it's an interesting subject because you're playing things exactly as Mozart wrote it. You're playing it just like Bach put it on the paper. How do you be expressive with that? All classical musicians have to express themselves are the dynamics and the timing. So they'll play like slightly out of time on purpose. They'll play with brighter tone or softer tone. They'll play with swells in volume or decrescendos, you know, because they can't change the notes. Imagine what a challenge that is to be expressive. You can't change the notes. All you have is dynamics to create your expression, you know? So it's really an interesting, when you hear like Glenn Gould play Bach as opposed to like any of the other classic players play Bach, or even Yo-Yo Ma when playing the Bach cello suites. He will put all sorts of things in there that other players don't, but he's staying exactly true to every note that Bach wrote. But he's messing with the timing and the volume and the tone. It's very subtle, very interesting. Let's look at item 8. This is a really neat study, and you may want to take notes on this one because it will help you choose notes that will have different emotions when you're playing an improvised solo, okay? So basically there are 12 intervals, and what that means is there are 12 different ways you can combine two tones. Let's start with square one. If I have a G, what's the next available note up from G? We're talking the chromatic scale, every fret. G sharp, right? So what if I was to combine G and G sharp? I probably wouldn't get asked back to the jam. Okay? However, that is a valid interval. It's called a half step. And some modern composers use it. Jazz musicians use it. I played a gig at a bar one time and I was really kind of annoyed. I was in a bad mood. No one was paying attention to me, which I used to have a problem with. And I'm playing my banjo. I'm playing a blues piece. I'm going. And all of a sudden I decided to go into half tones. I went. Got their attention. The stool swiveled around and I had 8 people paying attention to me. So I'm not saying that's a fair thing to do, but you can use that kind of dissonance in an improvisation to create emotion. Now I'll watch me do it in a more humane fashion. Here's my blues solo. ounces of halftone in there. But to me, it added that little squeeze of lemon I wanted, okay? Now, with that whole discussion was just on the halftone, that note that you should never use. Now, what if we combine a whole tone? The next note up in the scale is an A, A and G. That emotion's kind of soft, kind of relaxing. The half tone, very mean, nasty. Whole tone, it's acceptable. A lot of new age music and modern musicians use that. Okay, now we move it up one more, the minor third. Ooh, soft and sad. That's the minor chord. We move it up one more, we get the major third. Everything's all right with the world. The major third is the most annoyingly happy interval in Western music. Then we have the perfect fourth, strong and kind of peaceful. Like a march or something, okay? Then we go one fret higher, we climb all the way up to the sharp fourth, more known as the flat fifth. The single scariest note in Western music, known as El Diablos en Musica, the devil's note. And in fact, this note is so psychologically disturbing, that's why all alarm clocks and ambulance sirens use that. It was discovered over time that bothers the hell out of people. So it's an attention getter, okay? You can use that in your blues. Check this out. See, used in conjunction with other notes. Remember the most famous rock and roll riff in history? What makes that work is that devil's note. They're going 1 flat 3 4, 1 flat 3, devil's note down to 4, and that makes Smoke on the Water so epic. So now we've walked all the way up to the flat 5, then we have the perfect fifth interval. Super solid and strong. That's why all rock and rollers use 5 chords. They don't even use thirds. Power chords. It's a 1 and a 5. The fifth is super strong. One more fret, the minor 6, very soft. One more, the major 6. Soft but happy. One more, the flat 7. Blues, that's the blues note. One more, the sharp 7. Kind of dissonant but like elevator music. And then we're up to the final one, the octave, the 8th degree. So we just discussed all 12 intervals, and each of them has its own emotional value. So imagine that if you become familiar, and you should, when this goes on YouTube, rewind it and watch that section where I went through all 12 notes, and realize how powerful that is, that you now have 12 different emotions that you can inflict upon your listeners when you're soloing by choosing different intervals. That to me is extremely powerful. That's like a giant paint set right there. Now, let's go to item 9, note choices over chords. Here's another way to use emotion. Let's say the song was in C. Yes, it's a folk jam now. Folk singers, always in C. Or worse yet, they have a sore throat so they capo first fret and expect everyone to play in C sharp. Singer song whiners, never stop. So, the song's in C. I'm not a great singer, so pardon my voice, especially it's 10 a.m. for me. But let's say we played a third over that. La 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 la. Typical soft folk music. But let's say we did something outside of the chord. We went to a sixth. La 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 la. Now it sounds like it could be a swing song. It's kind of jazzy. Ba 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 da da. Okay, now let's look at the converse. Actually, I'm gonna make a G note. I can't sing that high. La. Most people think, oh, I'd play a G chord over that. La 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 la. Well, guess what? That G note also exists in a C chord. La 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 la. That G note also exists in an E minor chord. La 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 la. Ooh, see how much more different that exact same G note feels? So listen to the feeling of this G note I'm singing. La 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 la. And now listen to the feeling of this G note. La 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 la. had totally changed the emotion just by the chord I painted it with. What if I did something even weirder, G minor? La 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 la. I happen to know that there's also a G in the chord of E flat. La 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 la. Ooh, that's an interesting feeling there. All I'm doing is singing G notes. It's wild. You can paint any note with about five or six different chords, and we'll look this up later, but basically it depends on if the note you're painting is either the root, the third, or the fifth of the chord that you're painting it with. And of course, we'll discuss that in our personal lessons. Let's look at item 10, sweet and sour, consonants and dissonance. We spoke of this briefly earlier. Once again, if I know my consonant or good sounding intervals, but I also know some nasty dissonant intervals like the major second, I can start creating emotional tension between consonants and dissonance, or sweet sounding and sour sounding. So here's sweet, here's slightly sour, but now I can use it in a solo. I can go. So this by itself is terrible, that's the minor second, but then I went down to a minor sixth. So everything is relative when you're choosing note choices. All depends on what emotion you want to get out of it. Now, so that leads us into 11, special effects. Here is where I'm going to segue over and demonstrate with a solo that I played a long time ago with a really great jazz musician who was playing percussion and singing. And so he let me have a guitar solo, and I want to study this for a second so we can see me using what I call special effects, and then we'll break that down and discuss it. So he just pointed at me and I'm about to play a guitar solo. Listen to how I use silence and special effects. Here we go. Short solo I played, but I used a number of things that we've discussed. I used very sharp tones. I used soft tones. I used harmonics. I even used a neck wobble, which is dangerous. I used string squeaks. I used flapping. I had a whole lexicon of special effects that helped make that solo more unique, because it was a unique show. I mean, that was a very interesting performance, and it was a jazz show, and it was with percussion. So I had to choose something that worked with that format. So that ties into, think of those item 11 ideas of percussion, string squeak, and then I'm gonna talk about scatting. So here's percussion. Here I'm playing mandolin. I'm using that as part of my solo. And string squeak is more of a rock and roll thing, but you could get away with it if you're playing swing, maybe. Am I going? You know, just as a launch into a note, we could get into it with that sound. Scatting is when we sort of vocalize as we're playing our scale. And this will sound really bad at first, so do this with no one else around. Okay, but eventually you're going to be doing this. And I'm just making nonsense syllables, but connecting my voice with my instrument gives me more expression because I'm singing the notes, a little more like singing the notes. Now let's talk about the technical side of things. Item 12, the balance of scales and arpeggios. I want you all to think about this. To be expressive, you need to be able to go like this, like scales do, and then like this, like arpeggios do. Arpeggios have a lot more altitude, and scales are a lot more calm, okay? So let me demonstrate. I have my G arpeggio. I have my G scale. Good musicians weave back and forth. They'll go scale, arpeggio, scale, arpeggio, scale, arpeggio. So that said more because I'm able to go back and forth from scales and arpeggios, changing up the visual direction. That leads us into sound shapes. Let me open up a really interesting graphic. Sometimes I like to think of solos and sounds as actual like shapes that we're making in the sound sphere. You'll see my interesting scribbles. Yes, people think I'm a mad scientist, but this actually happens. So if I do this, that would be this shape. Ba-dap, ba-dap, ba-dap. I'm making a shape in sound. What if I doubled it up and I went, sound shape number two. So it's often helpful to actually visualize what you're doing with your sounds. What if I made circles like item three? I went dee da dee da, and the same thing higher. Same thing higher. I'm making shapes in sound. And you can kind of see that through written notation, but visualizing, it's a different matter. Visualized a scramble at the bottom and then I jump high up in the air. I know that sounds weird. Like item one here. This would be, if I saw that in my mind's eye, then I would go like this. And all of a sudden I have a very expressive phrase. What if item two, I did this? Same thing down. So I actually have visualized those two shapes before and then played that shape as best I could. And it was really a lot more expressive than I had just played it from my fingers perspective, okay? Let's look at 14, building a solo, okay? And this is a really interesting concept where if you have like some kind of non-bluegrass jam and you have, you know, some time to play, you don't want to throw the kitchen sink in right away. We want to build up to a compositional end. So say I'm playing a G solo. I'm starting here. This is my runaway. I climbed up here. Solo might have not been the best, but I developed it. I started with softer, quieter sounds and worked my way up in pitch and then kind of had my fun at the end and then bounced out of there. Building a solo is a really unique concept generally found with rock and roll artists and guitar players. It also works for bluegrass as well. Let's look at great solos and licks. I want to analyze a Charlie Parker lick because he's, you know, the man, brilliant saxophone player. I want you to listen to this saxophone solo, at least a little part of it, and we're going to try to figure out what makes it say so, so much. Just talking about that little bit right there is mind-blowing. He came out with that lick, which I stole directly. I fell in love with it like 20 years ago. That sound right there speaks of decades of loneliness and empty Harlem streets and foggy nights, and it has so much emotion in it. It's like six notes. And then he let the piano player go for a little walk, and then he came back in and started playing. That's an example of Mozart-level thought on expressive playing right there, just Mozart-level. So you have that phrase, if you analyze it, you played a G minor arpeggio. And then guess what, friends? He went to a scale, a G minor pentatonic scale. And then he ended on a fourth, on the interval of a fourth, which was not in the key of G minor. He hung it on a C. We talked about the fourth being kind of strong but mysterious, but it's amazing. That's a brilliant phrase right there. And I'm not sure he thought it out like that, but he was so emotionally connected with his instrument that he would use all these tools without even thinking about it. Brilliant stuff. And then we have, let me show you a guitar solo I did when I had a gig with Joe Craven. Some of you may know the name. And remarkable show. I was very lucky to play with him. And he let me take a guitar solo, and of course I took advantage of it. Right here. Demonstrating a number of the things we've discussed. I went from really slow to four times as fast. I used the sound shape of... And then I came in, I attacked my notes with percussion. You know, so all of these things I've discussed, good players, far better players than I, use them on a daily basis. So... you'll hear this now. When you go on YouTube and you sit down with a glass of wine or a cup of coffee, whatever, and you search around and look at great players, I recommend we all do this. YouTube is such a great resource, especially now that we're, you know, in our bubbles, because you can look up artists like Django Reinhardt, Stefan Grappelli, Jimi Hendrix, Eric Clapton, B.B. King, David Grisman. Look up these names. Ryan Cavanaugh, Bela Fleck. Chris Thiele. And when you're listening to them play, have a flippin' notepad there and start thinking about what they're using, and you'll see more often than not, it's a bunch of these things we talked about. It's not just their note choices. It's all the other elements of expression. Now, the Jedi levels, item 16. This is where you can't really teach this stuff because this is up in the Yoda sphere. But I do like to point my finger at it. It's been said by many, many great musicians that, first of all, you get to be really good in playing your instrument, and you play something and you hear it. But the next level is you hear it first, and then you play it. Because now we're listening to the mystical. Now we're channeling the voice of inspiration, the muse. Inspiration, the root of that word means in spiritus, to be in the spirit, to be of the spirit. And that's not even a religious thing. That's just like trying to play to something larger than ourselves, whether it's humanity or the God of your choice. Basically, we're trying to channel that through our instrument. So if we hear a phrase, let's say I'm playing in G minor. I'm going to hum what I'm hearing. Try to find that now. So I don't do that a lot. I'm still learning to do this. I'll be honest. I'm not at that level. I want to be at that level. But I heard that. I heard that voice. Not even a voice. I'm not even sure if it was an instrument. It almost sounded like a harp. I heard that shape. And then I went and tried to find it. So this is reversing the whole paradigm. Not what normally we play and we hear what we play. And we go, yeah, that sucked. Or, yeah, that was pretty good. Usually we say it sucked. But the next level is to try to hear something and then find it on your instrument. That's a high level, but we can get there. And then we have item B under 16, feeling and then playing. Here's an interesting exercise. You hit your thumb with a hammer. Instead of a stream of curses that would make a sailor blush, run over, pick up your instrument, and play for a minute. See how it feels to play while you're in physical pain. You'd be surprised. You might just go and put the thing down. But guess what? That had a lot of emotion in it, that phrase, because you were really feeling it. On a less extreme level, let's say you're just feeling really down and blue, which I think a lot of us are right now, because we've got all our toys taken away. At least I did. Then we could sit down and try to channel that sadness into a minor pentatonic scale. Take that G minor pentatonic. And that was about 60% for me, but I felt like I was tapping into feeling blue there, you know. And it was a simple phrase. It was a simple phrase. Feeling happy. You got your stimulus check or something. You're happy. You're going to go, you know, buy some margarita makings. So now we'll probably choose a pentatonic scale. I'll try to play exaggeratingly happy. Let's see how soon. Now it's almost annoying. But I was portraying sort of a feeling of me being giddy and happy. Hearing and then playing, feeling and then playing. Putting the channel and the emotion before the note. This is the Jedi level that we're all striving to get through. Finally, expressing emotions and changing emotions. This is the whole point. If we can express our emotions through our given instrument, whatever that instrument is, accordion, glockenspiel, you name it, then guess what happens when people listen to us? It changes their emotion. Okay? It's called entrainment in physics. One system will affect another system at a distance. Okay? So we can do that. We can have the ability to make people around us in a good mood, or as I've done on occasion, make people around us in a bad mood, or make people around us feel some emotional pain and then make them happy again. That's what the symphonies do. Great composers. If you listen, if you sit through Beethoven's Ninth, which few of us can anymore because our attention spans are so anemic, you'll go through a whole gamut of emotions from like depression to sadness to joy to, oh my gosh, this poor guy, he couldn't hear anything and he had a bedchamber bucket under his piano bench and yet he created this piece of music, you know? You'll walk out of the concert hall with a tear and a smile because you've been changed. And that's ultimately, I think, what we're all trying to do. Other than just jam and have a great time, we want to convey something to those around us that changes the way they feel. And right now, it's probably a good idea to make people happy as much as we can. That's why I write funny songs now. I used to be like such a dark songwriter writing about the fate of the dolphins and, you know, saving ourselves and how this woman stomped on my heart, et cetera, et cetera. And now I'm thinking, I just want to write songs like, you know, loving you ain't easy, but I hear your sister is. Because I want people to get a chuckle. I want them to go, I can't believe he said that. That's kind of rude, but hey, that's funny. Or maybe they don't think it's funny. And then I create the emotion of of annoyance in them. But I still created emotion. I created an emotion. So as you look through that syllabus, by the way, in the next couple weeks before we see you at our next lesson, try to think of this summation. It's not just the notes that we're thinking about. It's the volume and the tone and the attack and the timing and the silence and the thought in your state of mind and listening to try to hear something and then grab it. It's a lot more than becoming good on your instrument and then being able to spit out notes. That's your white belt. Now you're in the sandbox. To really play, or as my teacher used to say, to really pee in the high grass with the big dogs, we need to start thinking about these tools of expression. And I'm really glad you guys came to this workshop because I was a bit nervous. I'm like, how the hell do I teach this? This is wild stuff. But I learned a bit today myself. I learned that, especially I'm looking back over some of my previous performances, like I played for you, those were from 10 years ago. And first I thought, maybe I'm worse now. I said, in some ways, I played better then than I do now. But I think now I have more maturity, I would hope, and a little more expression and not so much notes. And so that's the one thing we can hope for. I hope you guys have a wonderful rest of your Saturday and a great Sunday tomorrow. And I will see you all at your own lessons with me soon. Thanks so much for being a part of this class. I'm grateful and honored to have all of you on board. I'll see all of you soon.